Hey everybody, Darren Boros here. Today I want to walk you through how to calculate your numbers on a rental property, or in other words, how to calculate cash flow. There's two reasons why it's really important that we know how to run our numbers properly. Number one, we have to be able to tell the difference between positive cash flow properties and negative cash flow properties. And I'll explain why positive cash flow is so important to the equation. Number two, so we can compare properties against one another. Sophisticated investors calculate their numbers the way that I'm about to show you. So if you're not calculating your numbers in the same way, you may think you have a great rental property when in fact you may not. I'll show you all the categories I use when analyzing the numbers on a rental property. And at the end of the video, I'll show you how you can tell what you should be paying for a property based on the cash flow analysis. For those of you new to me and my channel, I talk about three things: real estate, investing, strategies, tips, and techniques, financial freedom and financial independence, and renovation and construction. If you haven't already done so, you can subscribe to my channel. You can also hit the notification bell to be notified when new videos come out. And please feel free to leave comments and questions below for me. And without further ado, let's get into it. Before we jump into the numbers, I want to specifically define positive cash flow. Positive cash flow is super simple. It's where our monthly revenue exceeds all of our combined expenses. I only buy properties that have positive cash flow. If you're purchasing properties with negative cash flow, and what I mean by negative cash flow is if you're putting money into the property every single month, you're banking on one element of the real estate market, and that's appreciation, that the property value is going to go up. And the market does not always go up. The market is very cyclical. It moves in a circle. It goes up and down all the time. So if you're purchasing based on appreciation, I call that real estate speculating, not real estate investing. Real estate investors purchase for positive cash flow first, and everything else beyond that is a bonus. Positive cash flow is so important to the equation. It protects against rising interest rates, vacancies, and any unexpected circumstances, such as the global pandemic that we're dealing with right now. So how do you know whether you've got a property in positive cash flow or negative cash flow? Let me run you through some numbers and let's talk specifics. I see a lot of novice investors calculate cash flow like this. They look at their mortgage, property tax, utilities, and insurance. Anything above and beyond that is positive cash flow. But as you'll see, if we run the numbers in that way and then we run them properly later on, you'll see that you're actually going to be in negative cash flow if you just include those four things. So let's say we own a property that's worth $500,000, or we're looking to acquire a property that's worth $500,000. On that property, let's say we get a mortgage, and the mortgage that we usually get is 80% loan to value. So in this property, we'd have a 20% down payment. So that would leave us with a mortgage of $400,000. On a $400,000 mortgage at today's interest rates, our monthly payment with principal and interest, we'd be looking at about $2,000 a month. Let's say our property tax bill is about $350 a month, our utilities are around $150 a month, and our insurance is $100 per month. These four categories totaled up would equal $2,600. Let's assume that on a $500,000 property, we could get $3,000 a month in rent. You take the $3,000 in rent, you subtract the $2,600 in expenses, and you're left with $400. You might think that you've got a property here with positive cash flow, but by the end of this video, you'll understand that this property is actually in negative cash flow, and I'll show you how we calculate those numbers. So this is the proper way to calculate cash flow or calculate your numbers on a rental property. The first category we want to look at is revenue. What does the property bring in every single month? First and foremost is the rent that the tenants are going to pay us. And in a lot of cases, this will be the only revenue that we have on the property, but there might be some other situations where you have additional revenue coming in. Those categories could include parking, coin laundry, storage facilities such as a garage, a shed, or a workshop. So if we add up all of those categories, that would give us our gross revenue on the property. Once we've calculated our revenue, now we start to look at the expenses of the property. Let's talk about the four we've already mentioned, which are the mortgage, property tax, utilities, and insurance. The mortgage payment is very easy to figure out. If you already own the property, you can just look at what your mortgage payment is each month. If you're acquiring a property, there's all kinds of mortgage calculators online that you can use. You enter the mortgage amount, the interest rate you're going to pay, the amortization period, and it'll kick out the monthly payment that you're going to have. The second category is property tax. Again, if you own the property, you can look up what your tax bill is and what you pay on a yearly or monthly basis. If you don't own the property and you're looking to acquire a property, you can do two things. You can ask the sellers to give you an existing copy of their property tax notice, or you can go on the local municipality's website and they'll often have a property tax calculator on there. If you can't find either of those things, you can do a rough estimate. I generally use 1% of the property value value. So if the property value was $500,000 in this case, my property taxes would be approximately $5,000 per year. To figure out utilities on the property, again, you can ask the sellers of the property to provide you with utility statements, or you can ask the local utility provider to give you a quote on what the utilities might be on that property. The utility costs are going to vary from property to property because it really depends on who's paying for what. In some of my properties, I pay for all the utilities, and in others, I pay for none of them. So you want to look at who's paying for what. In the case of a tenant paying utility, I don't include that in my monthly costs because that's not going to be something that's coming out of my pocket. Make sure you look at all utilities, including gas, electricity, water and sewer, and garbage. Each municipality is slightly different, and some municipalities include certain services like garbage and water and sewer in your property tax. Let me give you a little tip when it comes to utilities. If your tenants have to pay their own utilities, make sure you get a landlord agreement filled out with that utility provider. If your tenants stop paying their utilities for whatever reason, your utility provider will send you a notification. This will save you money because if the tenant stops paying their utility bills, the utility company has to do a title search and figure out who owns the property. That costs money for them, so they're going to transfer that charge to you. So if you have a landlord agreement filled out with your utility provider, they'll automatically send you the utility bill that's owing on that property. And the last of our four original categories is insurance. If you already own the property, you have an insurance bill either on a monthly or yearly basis. You can look at what that is. If you're looking to acquire a property and you want to know how much insurance is going to cost, you can get a quote from an insurance broker on what a policy on that property would cost. So beyond those four categories, here are the ones you need to add to your cash flow calculations. Number one is vacancy. It's not a matter of if you're going to have a vacancy, it's when, and you want to make sure you've got enough money in your accounts to cover when your property is vacant. I like to use a minimum of 5% for vacancy, and I mean 5% of the gross revenue that you bring in every single month. In your local municipality, your vacancy rate might be less than 1%, but I would always use 5% as a minimum. If your vacancy rate is higher than 5%, then I would obviously use that higher number. And the reason why I use 5% as a minimum on my vacancy is because if you look at our rent of $3,000 on this property, 5% of that is $150 set aside per month. Well, it takes 20 months to build up enough reserve to be able to cover 1 month of the property being vacant, which means you can only have 1 month vacant out of every 20 months for a 5% vacancy allowance. And this is why I like to use a minimum of 5%. In this vacancy allowance, I would also include provisions for cleaning the property out when a tenant moves out and for advertising the property for rent when you need a new tenant. The second thing you want to include is property management. And I use 10% of the gross revenue every single month for property management. It doesn't matter whether you're managing the property or somebody else is managing the property for you. I see so many investors who manage their own properties and they don't include property management in their numbers. The reason I like to include a 10% property management fee, even if you are managing your own properties, is one, it's a write-off for the property. You'll pay less tax. And some of you may have to set up another separate company in order to be able to bill that company for property management fees. Some of you have a corporate structure already, so you can use your corporate structure to be able to bill your property management company as an expense against your real estate company. The second reason it's really important to pay yourself as a property manager is there might come a day where you don't want to manage that property anymore. Now you can hire a property manager and pay them what you're used to paying yourself, and it's not going to affect your cash flow moving forward. The third category I want you to include is repairs and maintenance. Some investors like to split out large capital expenditures like replacing the roof or replacing a fence versus small items like doing a hot water tank or a small repair. I like to combine the two, just call it repairs and maintenance, and I like to use the number of 5% on my standard properties. There are some exceptions to that 5% rule. For instance, if you have a brand new property, your repairs and maintenance should be much less than 5%, and a condo should be a little bit less because you don't have to take care of the exterior maintenance of the building. But I still like to include 5% on my condos because sometimes condos will have a cash call. Cash calls on condos are things that fall outside of your general maintenance fees. These can happen often or they can happen very rarely on a condo depending on which building you're in. And speaking of maintenance fees, if you own a condo, you'll have to include maintenance fees as part of your monthly expenses as well. Depending on the type of property you have, you may have to hire out landscape and snow removal. So if that's the case, you may want to include 7 to 10% of the gross monthly rent in your repairs and maintenance costs. And the last category I like to include are tenant gifts. I'm a big believer in what we call reciprocity, the idea of giving and taking with our tenants. I give my tenants about $100 per unit per property per year. I give them a gift on their birthday. How do I know when their birthday is? It's on their rental application. So get those rental applications filled out. Send yourself a reminder about a week before their birthday. Fill out a birthday card, stick a gift card in there, put it in the mail. Your tenants will be amazed that you remembered their birthday. I like to touch base with my tenants at least two more times throughout the year. It's usually for me summer and winter. In the summertime, you can give them something that's relevant for them. In the winter, right around the holiday season, I like to have my property managers drop off a gift basket. This is a great way to start to build rapport with your tenants and start to create a relationship. I am not going to sit here though and tell you it's going to solve all your problems. That is not what I'm saying. But it does start to create this relationship of reciprocity, giving and taking. So if we go back to our original numbers, we look at our mortgage of $2,000, our property tax of $350, our utilities at $150, and our insurance at $100, we were at $2,600. Now we have to add those four additional categories. So vacancy at 5% is $150 per month. Property management at 10% is $300 a month. Repairs and maintenance at 5% is $150 a month. And gifts at a half of 1% is $15 per month. That all adds up to an additional $615 per month. So now our total with all eight of those categories is $3,215. And if we're only collecting $3,000 a month in rent, now we're in negative cash flow of $215 per month. So we went from a situation where we thought we had $400 in positive cash flow to actually having $215 in negative cash flow. And this is why it's so important that we run our numbers properly. Because if we were looking to acquire this property, this would not be a property that I would want to put in my portfolio. So here's the beauty of running your numbers this way. If you're setting aside money every single month for vacancy, property management, repairs and maintenance, and gifts, and you're managing your own properties and you're not buying your tenants gifts because you're super cheap, well, then you're going to be saving yourself a lot of money every single month. Then you're gonna have money building up in your accounts every single month. And if you don't ever have those expenses, that's just money that you can collect as revenue. But if you do have those expenses, you've got a reserve built up in the account that you can pay those expenses out of that reserve from, and it's not money that you have to take out of your own pocket. Here is my tip when it comes to your reserve account. I would make sure I have at least 6 months of expenses built up in your reserve account before I start paying out cash flow. And finally, as promised, I want to show you a way that you can figure out what you should pay for a property based on the monthly expenses. Of the eight categories that we went through earlier, mortgage, property tax, utilities, insurance, repairs and maintenance, vacancy, property management, and gifts, the only one that you can really find savings in is the mortgage payment. So a very rough and easy number to remember is for every $100 in savings per month on your mortgage, that's about $25,000 less in property value. So in the case of our numbers earlier where we have $215 in negative cash flow, if I can reduce the purchase price by about $50,000, we should be very close to breaking even. So I know that I can buy this property for $450,000 and it should come really close to having cash flow. Obviously, those numbers are based on today's interest rates and interest rates are always changing. So make sure you're running your numbers on a regular basis because these numbers can all fluctuate over time. I hope you guys enjoyed the breakdown of how to be able to calculate your numbers properly on a rental property. If you did, hit that like button below. You can also subscribe to my channel, hit the notification bell, and please feel free to leave me comments and questions below. You can also follow me on Facebook, Instagram, or check out my website at darrenvoros.com. With that, I'll say thank you guys very much. I wish you the best of success in your real estate investing journey, and I look forward to hearing your success stories very soon.